Hey team, Andre from High Performance Academy here. Welcome along to another one of our webinars. Today we're going to be diving into a more advanced way of adding switches and driver controls to the steering wheel. Now, we are in our SR86, and I'll just get the steering wheel here into view, and we've got a bit going on here. Obviously going to dive in a lot deeper as we go through today's lesson, but basically a bunch of switches to control things on the back of that steering wheel as well. We also happen to have our paddles for our paddle shift, and traditionally one of the problems with doing this is it requires a lot of wiring to get between the steering wheel and the chassis. And yes, there are ways of doing this with a pass-through connector, basically an autosport connector built into the detachable hub. Those are expensive and require quite a lot of tricky wiring to get those working. The more usual technique is a curly cord. And once you start getting up in the conductor count in a curly cord, these become somewhat problematic in their own sense. So we're going to talk about CAN switch pads, what they are and how they work. We'll have a look at how we've interfaced the EC Master CAN switch pad in our SR86, some of the functionality that we are using within that. Before we dive into today's lesson though, just to catch up on a few things that have been going on over the last couple of weeks. And these pre-shows have of late become a bit of a rundown on our racing endeavors with the SR86. We're kind of in our off season at the moment. We've got a few months to go before we get into the meat of our racing, which is our endurance series. And for those who are longtime followers, you'll know that we continue to have our challenges thrown up by this car. We started really strong with an outright win in our first round, and then basically self-destructed into a range of problems, from suspension failures to cracked main caps in our SR20 block. We are hoping that we are getting closer to being on top of that. But one of the things we have been playing around with is some of the Aero development. And again, for those who have been following, we have put a Topstage Composites rear wing, rear diffuser and front splitter on the car. And those in their own right really transformed the car. For those who are maybe sort of wondering, well, what does this sort of bolt-on aero componentry really do? We're talking about increases of cornering speed just in one fast part of Highlands Motorsport Park, where we're up from a starting point of about 160 kilometers an hour. We were up about 17 kilometers an hour. That is huge. The other advantage is braking distances are reduced. We can brake later and carry more speed into the corner. So all things being equal, I think the Aero alone, and it's hard because we're not in a position where we tend to make just one single change, but if I could do a best guess, I think the Aero alone was good for about a reduction of 1.5 to 2 seconds per lap, around a minute 40 lap. So that's definitely a significant improvement. And you can see the Aero working not only in the increased cornering speed, but of course it does come at a cost, which is drag. And we were down around about 7 kilometers an hour in top speed down the fastest section of the front straight. So you know, despite that reduction in top speed, we're also significantly faster. That being said, we did still have some work to do, and we'll jump across to my laptop screen. It's a little hard to get a sense of all of this, but I'm going to try and talk you through it. And this is a view of the rear diffuser that is at the back of the car. Obviously, there's a hint there because it's a rear diffuser, not a front diffuser. Clearly, it's at the back of the car. And the problem with this as it's installed at the moment, and this was always going to be a temporary measure, is that you can see it's got essentially nothing to guide airflow onto it. We've got this sort of square upright lip at the front edge of it. So essentially we've got the air flowing from the front to the rear of the car in the direction I've just put that arrow, and there's nothing really to just guide it onto that diffuser. And what we really want the airflow to do is kind of stick to the underside of the surface there, and it sort of gives the downforce as a result of this and the pressure difference that is created. Now, not an aerodynamicist, just to be clear here. I'm just sort of giving a really high level view of what this does. But for it to be effective, we really need that air to be guided nicely onto the diffuser. We're going to instead have a whole bunch of turbulence caused by this flat face that the air is going to be hitting. Plus, we don't really have like nice smooth flow of the air under the car anyway, due to the fact it's going to be bouncing off all of the componentry under the car. Now, if we look at the front, so now we are looking from the rear of the car forwards, and this is obviously one of our brake cooling ducts, just to give you a bit of an idea, and this is the Topstage Composites front splitter. So again, we've got this little lip here, which is designed to sort of incorporate to a flat floor section. And again, we always intended to get this flat floor into place, but priorities, it just hasn't been something that we've been able to spend time on. One of the things we were quite careful of with when we were installing these components, and we were backwards and forwards talking to Freddie from Topstage Composites over in Australia about this. These aren't just off-the-shelf sort of eBay special components. These are actually designed with CFD, so they're a step ahead of the sort of eBay rear wings that you see around, and these are proper components, and Freddie's able to give us actual data on the sort of drag and downforce that they will produce. So one of the elements we talked quite closely to Freddie about, aspects of around the height of the diffuser and the splitter off the ground, and basically making sure that when we were installing these components, the likes of this front lip here at the back of the splitter and that flat section of floor at the back that we just looked at, or diffuser at the back, were in a line. So that was really important so we can integrate a flat floor. Anyway, moving forward, we finally got the opportunity to do this. So it's not an easy job. There's actually a bit more to it than I think we had originally considered. And it starts with this aluminium frame here that you can see that Jimmy and Brandon fabricated up. This bolts to the underside of the car. It actually spaces down off the underside of the car quite significantly. Also, what we can see here, and I'll talk a little bit more about this shortly, is we've got a little cutout on each side there for our air jacks. And we've also got these two knacker ducts. Again, I'll discuss those in a bit more detail. So this basically bolts to the underside of the car and it connects the front and rear. Now, I haven't got a picture of the whole thing installed. It's so reflective, it actually is just about impossible to get a good photo of it. But with the floor standing up, that's what basically the underside looks like now. So perfectly smooth, perfectly flat. And of course, we're expecting that this should help our aero performance. Now, a couple of things about this, because I know a lot of you will be thinking or asking what the material is that we've used here. So it's a material called Aluplast, and the hint in its name there is two very thin layers of aluminium sandwiched with plastic in the middle. It's not the best product because it is unfortunately quite heavy. This whole contraption, including the flat floor and the alloy framing that we made, is somewhere in the vicinity of about 16 kgs, so about 32, 35 pounds. Sorry, I can't do the math in my head there, but yeah, it's quite heavy, but I'll get into how we're gonna sort that shortly. You can see it's 4 millimeters thick. So one of the nice aspects about this with the construction, it is actually quite rigid. It's got quite a lot of strength to it. And obviously that's important because we don't want the risk of this coming loose and ending up under a tire or something of that nature. That's not gonna end well. So it's important to have something with a reasonable amount of rigidity on the car. Now, we've had two opportunities to shake the car down with the underfloor on it, and unfortunately at the moment we haven't really been in a position to get good solid data, but I just wanted to talk about the plan of how we go about this. First of all, before I talk about that, I just want to talk about one of the concerns we had, which is around the heat generated with that flat floor. And obviously we've got the exhaust system running under the car through the transmission tunnel. We've got our Hollinger SG3 transmission in there, the diff at the rear. And because this car is used for sprint and endurance events, heat control is something that we very much do take quite seriously. So by basically enclosing that underfloor, we're not allowing airflow through the transmission tunnel, or at least nowhere near as much airflow as we would normally get. And the other aspect there is we've got no easy way of getting the air in and out. So what we've done just to try and alleviate some of that or get some airflow in there is to add a couple of knacker ducts to the underfloor. So you can see one there in close up. And if I just go back a little bit, you can see we've got one at the front. Actually, that's the front there, and one at the rear. So that's just about getting some airflow around that exhaust. Now, again, a little too early in the piece to really have solid data on this. What we intended to do is actually temporarily fit a temperature sensor in the transmission tunnel, do some runs around our local track with and without that flat floor and just see how they compare. However, I do have some data that's of some value here. So I did a little club sprint event at Highlands Motorsport Park on the weekend, and it was only around a very short section of the track. So not a good test, but what we can monitor here, this is our transmission worksheet, and we've got transmission and diff oil temperature. And we do run an oil cooler for the Hollinger transmission. And you can see that through this section here, which is lap 11 of 13, our transmission temperature is sitting at 78 degrees. That's a little hotter than we've previously seen. Previously on some very long runs, around about 30 minutes of racing in very, very high ambient temperatures, certainly higher than we were seeing on the weekend. The highest we'd seen was about 75, 76. So to be able to get up to 78 under short run like we've got here, albeit running a quite a higher power setting, it suggests that we do definitely have a little bit more heat that's getting into the transmission. That being said, 78 degrees is still incredibly cold, and I wouldn't be concerned running that transmission temperature up around 100 degrees. So we've got no problem with that as it sits. So a little bit more testing to go. If we come back, I think my fastest lap of the session was lap 7, and you can see that transmission temperature staying pretty consistent, 76 degrees there. And I did slow down and do a cool down lap, but in the final lap, I think the highest we saw was 80 degrees was our peak temperature. So certainly nothing to worry about. It's looking reasonably good so far. All right, so how do we validate if these components work? And we're obviously not in a position where we can put the car in a wind tunnel. To the best of my knowledge, there's no wind tunnels in New Zealand, so just that's not a relevant technology. So one of the ways we can go about this is that we do have shock travel or damper position sensors on the vehicle. So obviously when we create downforce at speed particularly, what that tends to do is it compresses the car into the ground. So we can do some rough calculations, and admittedly they are quite rough, that's all they're good for, based on the spring rate, the wheel rate of the car more particularly, and we can do what's called a coast down test. So that's where we get the car up to a reasonably high speed where we know that the aero is going to work. I can get up to around 210, 220 kilometers an hour in the fastest section of the track, and basically disengage the clutch, so clutch in and just allow the car to coast and gather data. So what we can do there is basically go to the track and gather data in that way with the flat floor, then without the flat floor, and then we also want to actually remove the rear diffuser entirely and just see what each of those components is doing. Now, again, for the aero buffs out there, I know this is not a foolproof solution, but it is reasonably effective for our particular application, so much as we're at least getting some idea. And just to sort of see what those sensors look like, if we jump back over to my laptop screen, this is our right rear here, and you can see we've got a Penny and Giles linear travel potentiometer there that is located between the bottom arm and the chassis. One of the aspects when you're configuring and installing these you do need to keep in mind is the motion ratio. So that's our inner pivot there. This is our outer pivot here. Obviously out of shot somewhere over here, we've got the center of the wheel. And what we're really interested in here is the wheel travel. So here we've got our linear travel potentiometer, and then we've got our shock or damper itself. So there's a motion ratio related to each of the mounting locations of those. So there is a bit of calibration that is required in order to get actual useful data. Now, segueing nicely into our latest podcast release, and I did get the opportunity to talk to Andrew Brilliant from AMB Aero, who is a very well-regarded aerodynamicist in the motorsport industry, particularly on this side of the world. He's been involved in a couple of fairly high-profile World Time Attack cars, as well as numerous others that I won't go into. But in our interview with Andrew, we did actually talk about this exact technique. And to validate the data, that's really the key here in terms of getting an indication of for how many millimeters or inches of compression, what that actually relates to in terms of the load being applied by the aerodynamics. And he is an advocate of a test he calls the pylon test. So I dug in a little bit on that because obviously I was interested. And it turns out that the pylon test is simply where you get a bunch of your mates and get them to pile onto the car. And then you know the weight that is being applied to the car and you can measure or correlate that to the compression of the suspension. So sometimes you don't need to be spending millions of dollars on research and development. There are some techniques that for a modest cost will get you at least part of the way towards knowing what's going on. So there you go. We'll give you some more information on that as we actually get the opportunity to do those coast down tests. But as I mentioned, segueing into our podcast, if you've been living under a rock, you may be interested to know that High Performance Academy now has our very own podcast. That is the HPA Tuned In podcast. And we'd love it if you could go along and have a listen. And if you like what you're hearing, leave us a rating and leave us a review. We always love to hear what our listeners are liking, disliking for that matter, and what other guests you'd like to have along. So as I mentioned, we've got Andrew from AMB Aero joining us this week. And just to give you an idea, here we go. If we jump across to my laptop screen, a couple of the cars that I mentioned there is involved with at the World Time Attack event, which we're actually off to in a few days' time. This is the Scorch Racing S15. And as you can see, a lot of stuff going on there. It's pretty far removed from a factory Nissan S15. Another car that is well known for is the Life Motorsport R35 GTR, which did do an appearance at World Time Attack and is also racing. I think it's the Grid Life events in the US, among others, such as Pikes Peak. So really interesting to get an idea from Andrew on what goes on into the design and development of aerodynamic components for cars, how he goes about it, what his philosophy is. The fact that downforce is not everything when it comes to the development of these components as well, and how to design so that the team that own the car are actually able to produce these parts, because there's no point designing the most intricate components in the world that require pre-preg layup and the use of an autoclave in order to actually produce a finished item. So yeah, there's a lot of great information in that podcast, and I would urge you to go along and check that out. Remember, you can check that out at HPA-tunedin. You can listen to it or find it anywhere that you currently listen to podcasts. Now, on that note, I just talked about the actual production of parts. And if we come back to the flat underfloor, I mentioned that the Aluplast that we're using at the moment is reasonably heavy, that whole unit, somewhere around about 16 kgs at the moment. And that is quite a bit of weight to be adding to the car, which obviously weight is the enemy. We don't want to do that. This is simply a test. And if we do find out that flat floor, first of all, doesn't cause the car to overheat and burn to the ground, that would be number one. It would also be really nice. And also gives us a nice bump up in terms of a improvement in downforce, a reduction in drag, or potentially even both. Then what we will do is we will be redesigning that component and constructing it out of a carbon Nomex honeycomb core, and we'll be vacuum bagging that. So with that, we're expecting that should get us somewhere around about 1 to 1.2 kgs per square meter. So probably the whole thing there, around about 3.5, maybe 4 kgs, plus the weight of that aluminium frame, which is around 4 kgs. So from 16, we should be down to around 8, so around half. So quite a significant saving. And on that note, I'd like to ask you a favor. We always are looking at new course ideas. And for those who've been following recently, you know that we've branched out into fabrication. We've just released our fabrication fundamentals and TIG welding, practical TIG welding courses. Another area that we're really interested in developing, and we're considering doing some course material around, is composites for motorsports. So basically how to make components out of Kevlar, carbon fiber, fiberglass, etc., how to make molds, and with a really specific slant around motorsport components there. So let us know in the comments if that's something that you would be interested in. We'll gauge the interest out there, and it's something that we may well develop in the near future. All right, enough with our pre-show. I do appreciate you tuning in and watching. Give me a few moments and we'll get started with today's lesson.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.